understanding of that and keep monitoring of that, because we have right to information now, which is again a very positive act. Secondly, we need to read Chief Commissioner's office reports and see what they are, whatever level what they are claiming for planning and what they are claiming that what they have done. Like one gentleman, Mr. Iyer over here, mentioned about what the Railway Ministry is claiming to be. So we need to monitor those. What they have said, at least, does that exist? And we need to continuously guide, we need to bombard the Chief Commissioners and State Commissioners' offices and keep telling them what we want from them. And they better do it, because they are getting salaries for what? Full time. Chief Commissioner, Commissioners are supposed to be full time workers for this act. And like this, today's is one example where we need to keep having these kinds of workshops, where we continuously educate ourselves and learn from each other what is happening in the country and how we need to go about it, how it relates to me, to you, and to others. Sorry, finished. Thank you. Okay, it's you motivated me to think like that. I had not thought of it before. It had never occurred to us. Yeah. Can we take any questions? I don't know. Okay. Fine. Take it,
take it. It's so sorry that I had to come and intervene in this session, which has been very interesting for all of us. And thank you very much, Vandana. It was very, very informative and it got us thinking. Before we break now, this is the lunch break, I'd just like to announce that everyone should please take their coupons from outside and be back here in the hall for 2 o'clock. At 2 o'clock sharp, we will start. So you need to be back over here by 2 o'clock. Lunch is in the adjacent building. So those of you who are staying there already know. The rest of you can just follow. It's not very far at all. It's just a 2-minute walk.
Interpreter here, who's interpreting for the afternoon session? Roma, who's interpreting for the afternoon? Can we have the afternoon interpreter up, please? You all done a very important job. At the end of the meeting, this is the problem we have. No minutes. First half is good, but you were not reporting for first half. I saw them. Friends, can you take your seats quickly, please? Where is the person here? We don't have the... Who's the interpreter for the afternoon? They've gone to get her.
Yeah, 3-4 are recognized. I don't think they're here.
Hmm?
Aruna comes up.
Hmm. We'll take questions till about 2:50, 2:10, 2:15, 2:10.
Whatever.
We'll take 2:10 and... So that then they can now. Your कैमरा कैमरा को किसके ऊपर है कैमरा कैमरा गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड्स कुड एवरीवन टेक देयर सीट्स प्लीज बिफोर वी स्टार्ट द सेकेंड सेशन वी वॉन्ट टू जस्ट कंक्लूड द अर्लियर सेशन वेयर वील टेक क्वेश्चंस फॉर 10 मिनट्स एनीबडी हैज एनी क्वेश्चंस ऑन द पार्स एंड फंक्शंस ऑफ द कमिश्नर टू एनी क्वेश्चंस एड्रेस टू वंदना बेदी वील टेक 10 मिनट्स एंड देन वील स्टार्ट द सेकेंड सेशन
Has a question on that? Yeah, please turn to us. I'll be good.
Ma'am, I believe that many of the state commissioner for disabilities are not having the independent charge of this office, but are having this as an additional responsibility. And in an conference, I came to know that many of them actually, by the time they realize that they are state commissioner for disabilities also, and they need to do something about this area also, they are transferred to another department. And they actually are not able to contribute much in that area. Isn't it possible that we have an independent person for State Disability Commissioner?
Yeah, the issue you have raised is absolutely right. And a lot of noise, you know, in certain states, in certain places, the disability sector has been making to have the independent charge commissioners with the independent charge. The annual reports give a list of commissioners in all states, names, telephone numbers, and also whether the commissioner is with an independent charge or has an additional charge. Now, what we have found is that the only way, because the Act gives you that, it's not that the Act says have a commissioner with an additional charge. That person is not going to work out. It is a full-time work. So the law gives you the right to ask for it. Now what we have seen is that wherever people have made the loudest noise, there finally they have got into the system of having a independent charge commissioner. So I guess that's what one will have to do. And also, not just leave at that. To make that commissioner functional, it'll have to be an ongoing process until it comes into the system. Now, somebody has given it in writing. Mr. Raghava. Yeah. Mr. Raghava. Okay. He says at Chennai, the commissioner for disabled appointed in the coordination committee one blind one orthopedically handicapped
but no hearing impaired
for deaf category you know it's I think I can't for deaf category be appointed a normal body
a non-disabled person non-hearing impaired the question is that in Tamil Nadu, the appointees to the state committee were in the blind category. They put a visually impaired person in the orthopedically impaired category. They put an orthopedically impaired person, but in the hearing impaired category, they didn't choose to put a hearing impaired person. They put a non-hearing impaired person. Is that right, Mr. Raghava?
That's the question. That is exactly the question.
Yes. See, this is the state committee situation. The central coordination committee or executive committee situation. I'm in the CEC. I've been raising for last 3 years that there is no person with hearing impaired and they have put a person from the hearing impaired field,
not hearing impaired person, and also as far as mental disability is concerned, there we don't even have a person representing mental disability, either mental retardation or mental illness. Now the I keep raising this question at all such forums, that look at this, we are allowing, I would say that disability sector is allowing this to happen even in the central executive committee. So forget about the state committees, which are supposed to follow the, you know, system of CCC and CEC. So I think we, like we have done dharnas for other things, we need to raise a lot of noise, and we need to do dharnas with this information, that about members, who are the members and how, who all should be there, and also the number of meetings in the committees. CEC is like, are supposed to have 4 meetings a year. They used to have twice a year. Now in the last 1 year, CEC, I know, has had 3 meetings a year. This year we have had only 2 until now. So whereas some time ago, I think that was in 99 or 2000, Supreme Court gave directive, because meetings were not happening, case was put up in the court, and the Supreme Court gave direction to the ministry and the Chief Commissioner's office to hold the stipulated number of meetings in a year. This is a situation after that. So at all forums we need to raise this issue and probably have a dharna at state level, at central level.
No, as per the act, you have to, in the central coordination committee and state coordination committee, so many normal persons are there representing the government, about 17 persons are there. For NGOs, you have to select 5 persons, one for the blind, one for the orthopedically handicapped, one for the deaf, and one for mentally retarded persons, and another for athletics, 5 persons.
Yes.
For mentally retarded persons, I agree, you can that is nominate other normal persons. For deaf persons,
there should
why
be a parent.
People discriminate the deaf, why you are selecting a normal lady who is not representing in non-government? Suppose he is V. Swaminathan is there, he is a BSc graduate. He is working in Indian Overseas Bank. He is president of Tamil Nadu State Federation of the Deaf. He can be nominated. He is well qualified. So Tamil Nadu State Federation of the Deaf was discriminated, and this normal lady was nominated as representing the deaf. I feel it is very discrimination against the deaf people.
Yes.
And so even after I filed the case in High Court, the High Court also dismissed my case. I felt it very bad. So I had to file the case in the Supreme Court through
SLR. Okay. I was about to say. So
you kindly explain why such things happen in the.
I'm going to answer that question. The thing is that laws are made and laws are broken, and when laws are broken, then we have to do something to take the people who break them to task. So you went to court. Now the court didn't listen, and then now you're in the Supreme Court. The point is that what you're saying is correct. That's the way it should be. Unfortunately, it's not always the way it is. The way it is not what should be. That's the only answer that there is really to give. There is no reason why a hearing impaired person should not be on that committee. That's what the law says. That's what should happen, but it's not happening. And that's why we have to take recourse to courts or other methods of advocacy.
And I would just like to add to that, that recently the example what happened in the Planning Commission meeting of, that was steering committee meeting. If you know the system, there are steering committees to work out the Planning Commission work for the next 5 years. In the steering committee, now this time there is Mr. Narayanan, a person with hearing impairment. He is a member of that. And what we are realizing is that, you know, also the steps, we are learning the methodologies of how to get
are issues understood and approved at such levels. Now what happened that before that we had had dharnas about the disability sector is not being involved. So they became aware. The planning commission, our own member, social welfare member, steering committee member or chairperson who is looking into the disability area, he was so angry in the beginning that how can disability sector do this? How can you have dharna against planning commission? It has never happened in the history of India. He was very angry with us. Slowly changed, became, within few days, became pro-disability because we had planning commission members within. And when the steering committee meeting happened, was to start, they were made to realize that Mr. Narayanan is present there and there is no interpreter. And you should have seen, Mr. Arun Rao would vouch for it, he would vouch for it. I heard, you should have seen how scared they felt and what they were really nervous that, you know, this is going to be a very big chaos and disability sector is going to be very angry because we have been talking about it, we have involved a hearing impaired person and then there is no interpreter. So they apologized 10 times, they mentioned in between the meeting and they had an interpreter. So I think this is how, along with the courts, this is how also one would have to work, that we will have to make lot of noise. Dr. Monte Kaluwalia told us, he said that we are not fully aware of these things. If you make lot of noise, we will become aware and we'll do it. That's in India has so many issues that whoever makes the largest noise gets heard. That's what Dr. Monte Kaluwalia Singh told us.
Friends, we'll just have to take just two more questions because it's already 2:10 and we need to get into the session for the afternoon.
Can I, or should I leave it for somebody else from the sector? Mine is regarding the disability commissioner's office in certain states. For example, in the state of Gujarat, the commissioner himself says that he dissuades people from coming up and registering cases against anybody, and he tries to do counseling. Is he authorized to do so? And if something like this happens, what recourse do people have?
No, he's not authorized to do so. His job is to safeguard the rights of people with disabilities, and certainly part of that is not to counsel them to give up those rights. And if that is happening and if people are being denied their rights, then the next course of action is to go to the next authority, which is the High Court.
And if, like, for example, in the state of Kerala, for the second time now, you're aware that the earlier commissioner actually said, why should I meet with a jumping man, dancing man and stuff like that, in a very derogatory manner when it came to persons with disability. You now have somebody who's not at all interested in this, in the affairs of persons with disability. Again, do they go to court? Because they've actually approached the minister, they've approached a lot of bodies. So, do they have a case to go to High Court with? I mean, this is the case in most places. In Maharashtra, you go, the person sits in Pune. You have that issue coming up. And if you look at, I think Karnataka is the only state where, to an extent, the commissioner has been, you know, proactive, where he's actually called organizations which are giving legal aid to come and sit in his office and say that, you know, you help us, tell us how we can help these people, or you can take up the cases to court. He's actually asked lawyers to come.
See, what you can do is, under RTI, you can ask for the records of the office of the state commissioner. Those will tell their own story. The offices which are proactive, automatically you will see a large number of cases, a large number of decisions having gone out, positive orders having been issued. The state commissioner of Karnataka, for example, is so disgusted with the state government because they are not following the roster system that he's come against an order of the High Court in a special leave petition to the Supreme Court. So automatically from your RTI you will be able to immediately on paper see the effectiveness or otherwise of the state commissioner, and then of course you have a cause of action to say that if this man is not effective in looking after the rights of the persons with disabilities, then he should not be here in this post at all.
We'll just take the last question, okay, Bhushan? Yeah, last question. But friends, we are here, so most of us are staying now, I think. So at the end of the session, following this, we'll do an open house discussion, since there are many, many questions.
There are two questions. One is that with regard to the disability commissioners, in the last session, we have seen the powers under the Civil Procedure Code. Now, the disability commissioner, does he have any powers to give any kind of relief? Because some of the lawyers, we are discussing among ourselves that because the remedy is provided, we have to exhaust the alternative remedy of going to the disability commissioner and then going to the High Court. But if he cannot give any effective relief, then is it mandatory to go to the disabilities commissioner by way of a complaint or a representation and then go to the High Court? That's one question. The second question is...
I'll answer that first question right away, because I think it's a very important question, and it's a question that we've been all struggling with, and I've also had a lot of issues on that point. And what I'm coming to slowly realize is that if we look at the Disabilities Act, and if we try and look at another act which came in and which has something similar there, though it has a hierarchy which we don't have, that is the Consumer Act. The Consumer Protection Act also does not give the consumer court power to execute decrees. They have the power to send the execution to the civil court. Now, here also in our act, what it says is that the commissioner has wide powers, the powers of a civil court, as far as the entire gamut of actually conducting the case is concerned, the power to call witnesses, summon documents, so on and so forth. And then if we look at it, there is a section 62 which says that he has the right to forward this to the appropriate authority. So what I think we should do is that taking these powers, reading them in context of section 60, reading section 62 in context of these powers, and the fact that it says that he has the right to pass an order. The act specifies that he has the right to pass an order. It doesn't talk about implementation. Therefore, that should be taken up under section 62, and we should file an execution petition saying this is an order that was passed, it has not been acted upon, this is an infringement of a right of a person with disability, please send it to the civil court for execution, and the execution will happen in the normal course. If the person does not comply, he can be given free board and lodging by the government.
Thank you. Next question is with regard to the certificates, because repeatedly there are a number of complaints about the certificates not being given, or they are sent from pillar to post, and number of such complaints have been coming. Also, the practices followed in different parts are different and things like that. Can in these 2 days, can we have some sort of guideline or formation in which the identity or disability can be sort of the criteria laid down or some such thing, and simplest possible manner in which certificate should be issued, if you can do some exercise on that. I don't know whether it is possible.
See, the trouble is that each state, what we have realized is that each state has its own individual kind of problems with regard to these certificates. So the trouble is that there is no kind of a common formula, one shoe fits all. And actually, before we take any action in the disability sector, what we're becoming conscious of is the fact that from every state, we need to understand what are their limitations and what exactly are their needs. So what has happened now is that on an experimental basis, six mobile courts have been set up, which will not only grant disability certificates, but also all the other allied concessions, either in one day or if not in one day when they are posted over there, then they will also take on record a representation from the disabled person stating that a particular NGO or somebody is entitled to act on their behalf. Now, I think that this may be a sort of a a solution at least to the first step, which is that there is no accessibility, there are no proper medical boards, and there are no qualified people available to give those certificates when people go to get them, to actually avail of the opportunity, particularly in small rural areas and so on, you know, far-flung areas. So I think this is something that the disability sector can push for.
Just lastly, I would like to add one small thing, that to all these questions related to chief commissioners or commissioners not being functional, another point which we need to debate is that should we be now asking for a commission, like a women's commission, or a separate ministry for people with disabilities? Because you see, it's a law. The act is a law, and Supreme Court judges and, you know, those people understand it more in order to implement it. Now, it's like in a commission, there is always a judge, a Supreme Court judge. Should we, and the level of chief commissioner, the way we have seen, comes down. They are not able to take it up. So should we raise the level to commission? Should we now be fighting for commission so that you know, other law people can also enter the panel and influence all the various players in it?
Thank you, Ms. Vedi. We now conclude actually the session that was before lunch, and we are going on to the session on women's rights and violence against women. Actually, this is a particularly critical session, because if you see, especially among deaf women, there's much violence both within the family as well as from outside. I'd like to call our panel members up. Roma, of course, is already on stage. Anubha Rastogi, just to introduce her, also a practicing lawyer on women's rights in HRLN in Delhi. Khadija is also from HRLN, will be joining us shortly. And I would request Doma from our Sikkim unit to facilitate this session. The session is going to start a little late, but we'll go on till about 5:15 and open up the session for questions. Thank you.
May I request now Roma to speak on the issues of a disability right?
Because of a large number of requests, and because I had taken a session with hearing impaired women in an NAD workshop, I realized that there was a great need for this and the following two sessions, and there were a lot of queries that people had, and there were a lot of question marks on what their rights were. So this session, my session, is devoted to property and inheritance laws. I am going to be speaking about the various kinds of inheritance laws. In our country, inheritance laws are dependent upon the religion to which you belong, because there is a segregation based on your religion. I'm going to take up first the Hindu Succession Act. What I want to tell you is that the Hindu Succession Act has been amended last year. So I'm going to give you a little bit of a brief on what the position was prior to the amendment and what it is post the amendment. Prior to the amendment, only amongst the Hindus, we had a concept of what we called a Hindu undivided family. So the family was one unit, and the head of the family was called the Karta, his wife and his sons were part of this Hindu undivided family, and they were the inheritors. The daughters did not have a share. up till last year. Last year, the act was amended, and now the daughters have been given a full share in the Hindu undivided family, as also in other properties.